God, as we come to you today, we just invite you in. Lord, as we come to worship you, let us worship you in spirit and in truth. God, we just count on that visitation from the Holy Ghost of God today. And we just lift you up in Jesus' name. Yes. Amen and amen. Amen. Father, I just feel like something good is about to happen. As we sing this song, go around, shake somebody's hand, hug their neck, tell them you're glad to see them.
Well, I just feel like something good is about to happen. I just feel like something good is on its way. I just feel like something good is about to happen. And brother, it could be that very day. If God's people would humble themselves and call on Jesus and expect
reach out.
Said she wanted to hear this song tonight. We're going to sing the first and the last.
What a wonderful change in my life I have wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I have sought. Since Jesus came into my heart, floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart, I shall go there to dwell in that city I know, since Jesus came into my heart. And I'm happy, so happy as onward I go, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart.
Amen. 359.
Pull that one off, didn't
we? Barely.
Two verses. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning on Jesus, I'm leaning on Jesus, I'm safe and secure from all alarm. Leaning on Jesus, I'm leaning on Jesus, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim's way. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning
and secure from harm. Leaning on Jesus, I'm leaning on Jesus, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning on Jesus, I'm leaning on Jesus, I'm safe and secure from all alarm. Leaning on Jesus, I'm leaning on Jesus, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms.
Amen. Page 368, nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. I think I'm going to have me a t-shirt made that says, if you take the blood out of this thing, you only going to have a thing. You know what I'm saying? It's just a thing. You know what I'm saying? If you take the blood out of this thing, it's just a thing anymore.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is thy flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood
sometime before you you fail to see me. Let me tell you where I'll be. I'll be thanking Christ, my Savior, for saving a wretch like me. But if you should reach that city before my time has come, perhaps you'd like to greet me when my race down here is run. Just wait for us to be coming across life's living sea. And I'll tell you now, dear loved one, just wait to wait for me. Don't look beneath the gates of pearl. Don't look on the streets of gold. Don't look by the walls of Jasper, nor among the many sights untold. For I've been longing and I've been waiting for the precious Holy One to see. There I'll be through the countless ages. Look for me at Jesus' feet. There I'll be through the countless ages. Look for me at Jesus' feet.
Amen. That's where you're going to find me.
No. CD or mini disc?
CD.
So I'm going to preach a little bit, okay? Preach a little bit. Go to a party with the king of kings. A major celebration called the famous sensei. You got an invitation, so you better be there. They're calling it the marriage supper of the lamb. Everybody's gonna rock. Everybody's gonna rock. Yeah. We'll be raising it around the clock. We'll be rocking it with the city rock. Well, you go on the world is the charismatic road by road. It doesn't make a difference if you're black or white. As long as your foundation is Jesus Christ, we're gonna rock. Everybody's gonna rock. We'll be chasing him around the clock. We'll be rocking with the wind and rock. Well, you can't get in by the sea and scale. It has been paid by the blood of the Lamb. So whether you're rich or you're from the hood, you better get in while the getting good. So rock. Everybody's gonna rock. We'll be raising him around the clock. We'll be rocking with the wind and rock. Church house rock.
Now, I don't know about you, but I'm planning on partying when I get there.
When we finally stand behind the pearly gates, you know we're gonna dance. Celebrate. We're gonna worship God and have a real good time. And when we hear the master call, come and die. We're gonna rock. Everybody's gonna rock. We'll be praising him around the clock. We'll be rocking with the living rock. Now, if you want the promise of eternal rest, you better take the time to give the Lord your best. And if you want focus on the judgment day, you better know that Jesus is the only way. We're gonna rock. Everybody's gonna rock. We'll be praising him around the clock. We'll be rocking with the wind and rock. Rocking with the wind and rock. Rocking with the wind and rock.
Amen.
Let's keep going, boy.
Both wise and foolish choices.
Though I've heard some praise, I've also heard some angry voices. But if I would offend, I'd turn to God. Softly I pray, oh Lord, teach me that I might do it God's way. For what is a man who can compare to the Most High? How could he bear for Christ to die upon that tree? Gave up his life to make us free. Let his record show that he turned and chose to do it God's way. Let his record show he turned and chose to do it God's way.
Let his record show that he turned and chose to do it God's way.
Amen. 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 That's,
hope you enjoyed that.
That was what a creative mind.
Jingle bells. My version. Oh, you should hear that one sometime.
I enjoy somebody with a creative mind like that. As he was singing that, the only thing I was thinking about the words of the song, and I was thinking about Elvis Presley on his final tour in that white jumpsuit. And I was thinking how Brother Ken on his final tour when he leaves this gonna be up there in heaven. Amen.
We've got a bad feedback up here.
Yeah. Praise the Lord.
Y'all help us sing.
You want to stand? Stand and sing with us. Right. You might be sitting a while because he's preaching tonight, so it might be long-winded.
Don't threaten us.
Talking to the Father when the glory of the Lord came down. I cried, Jesus, please save me. He came and forgave me, and the glory of the Lord came down. I said, the glory of the Lord came down. The heavens fell all around. I was
to be here. How about you?
Preacher got a
know before we pray. An unspoken prayer.
If you have your Bibles tonight, turn to the book of Judges. Judges chapter 21. Judges chapter 21. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the songs. God, as we enter into this time, I pray that you bless the reading of the Word of God. God, I pray that you'd hide me behind the cross. God, I pray that your message would come forth today. We just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. We're in Judges chapter 21, but I want to read to you Judges 17 and 6. In those days, there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. We'll begin reading in Judges 21. Now the men of Israel had sworn in Mizpah, saying, "There shall not any of us give his daughters unto Benjamin to wife." And the people came to the house of God and abode there till even before God, and lifted up their voice and wept sore, and said, "O Lord God of Israel, why is it this come to pass in Israel, that there should be today one tribe lacking in Israel?" And it came to pass on that morrow that the people rose early, and they built there an altar, and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. And the children of Israel said, "Who is there among all the tribes of Israel that come not up with thee, with the congregation unto the Lord?" For they had made a great oath concerning him that came not up to the Lord in Mizpah, saying, "He shall surely be put to death." And the children of Israel repented them for Benjamin their brother, and said, "There is one tribe cut off from Israel this day. How shall we do for wives for them that remain, seeing we have sworn by the Lord that we will not give them of our daughters to wives. And they said, What one is there of the tribes of Israel that came not up to Mizpah to the Lord? And behold, there came none to the camp for Jabesh-Gilead to the assembly. For the people were numbered, and behold, there were none of the inhabitants of Jabesh-Gilead there. And the congregation sent thither 12,000 men out of the valley, and commanded them, saying, Go and smite the inhabitants of Jabesh-Gilead with the edge of the sword, with the women and children. And this is the thing that ye shall do. Ye shall utterly destroy every male and every woman that hath lain by men. And they found among the inhabitants of Jabesh-Gilead 400 young virgins that had known no man by laying with any male. And they brought them unto the camp to Shiloh, which is in the land of Canaan. And the whole congregation sent some to speak to the children of Benjamin that were in the rock, Rimon, and to call peacefully unto them. And Benjamin came against at the time, and they gave them wives, which they had saved alive of the women of Jabesh-Gilead, and yet so they sufficed them not. And the people repented them for Benjamin, because that the Lord hath made breach in the tribes of Israel. Then the elders of the congregation said, How shall we do for wives for them that remain, seeing the women are destroyed out of Benjamin? And he said, and they said, There must be an inheritance for them that be escaped of Benjamin, that a tribe be not destroyed out of Israel. Howbeit, we may not give them wives of our daughters, for the children of Israel have sworn, saying, Cursed be he that giveth to the wife of Benjamin. Then they said, Behold, there is a feast of the Lord in Shiloh, yearly in a place which is on the north side of Bethel, and the east side of the highway that goeth up from Bethel to Shechem, and on the south of Lebanon. Therefore they commanded the children of Benjamin, saying, Go and lie in wait in the vineyards, and see and behold if the daughters of Shiloh come out and dance the dances. And then come ye out of the vineyards, and catch ye every man his wife of the daughters of Shiloh, and go to the land of Benjamin. And it shall be, when their fathers or their brethren come unto us and to complain, that we shall say unto them, Be favorable unto them for our sakes, because we reserve not to each man his wife in the war. For ye did not give unto them at this time that ye should be guilty. And the children of Benjamin did so, and took them wives according to the numbers of them that danced whom they caught. I want you to notice that. The ones that danced to whom they caught. And they went and turned unto their inheritance, and repaired the cities and dwelt in them. And the children of Israel departed thence at the time, every man to his tribe and to his family. And they went out from thence, every man to his inheritance. And then read verse 25. In those days there was no king in Israel. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. I want to tell you today, they had no king. They had no king. I want you to think about this story that we just read. They said, well, what are we going to do for the wives, for our sons? What are we going to do for wives of the soldiers? And they said, what I want you to do is go out there and wait. And they have a feast. They have a dance. And when they come out to dance, we want you to go out, and we want you to take the one of your choosing. Just go out there and take the one. Just do kind of what you want to do. Do what you want to do there. Because every man did what he thought was right in his own what he thought was right in his own eyes. Kind of sounds like America today, doesn't it? We kind of just do what's right in our own eyes. Kind of seems like the folks today just whatever, any kind of way the wind blows, let's just let the wind blow and figure out which way the wind blows, and that's what we're going to lean on to. It's kind of what America does today. America has no obedience to God. They have no comprehension of God. America doesn't try to stay in the will of God. People just want to do what's right in their own eyes. Now, people are more interested in what their peers think in America. Think about it. Man, we need revival in America because all people care about is what their peers think. If it's okay for this group, it's just okay. Listen, it's not okay. Everything's not okay today. We live in a society where people think they can do anything and get by with it, and God's not happy with it. People need to realize that God's not happy with that. Whatever your peers think, that doesn't mean it's okay with God. What the world thinks, doesn't mean it's okay with God. We need to be more interested in God, what God wants. And then we're more interested in what society thinks. It kind of sounds like some churches today. Oh, me. Kind of sounds like some churches today. Well, you know, hey, that's how they do it everywhere else. Listen, it don't matter how they do it everywhere else. It matters what God tells you to do here. What God tells you to do in your fellowship of believers. What God has lined up in the Holy Bible for you to do. That's what you do. It don't matter what they do everywhere else. Listen, if God tells you to do it, you need to do it, and it needs to line up with this Bible right here. We get into the position where it's okay because the other churches are doing it. Listen, it is not okay to skirt around whether you need to be born again by the blood of Jesus Christ to be saved. It's not okay to skirt around that. That's what's wrong in America today. We've taken the blood out of the churches. We've taken the blood out of the pulpits. And folks are dying and going to hell sitting on church pews because men of God don't have enough nerve and women of God don't have enough nerve to stand up and tell folks about the blood of Jesus Christ and how to get saved and how to repent and turn from their wicked ways. We can tickle people's ears and we can tell them good stories and we can build them up and prop them up and send them out the door to get slaughtered by the devil. But we don't have enough backbone in the churches to stand up in the pulpit and preach about the blood and salvation. I want to tell you today, we always talk about that's just old-fashioned. Let me tell you what the hottest thing going today is old-fashioned praise and worship. Amen? That's the hottest thing going today. Listen, I got phone calls today of people said, man, listen, you could just feel the Spirit of the Lord move through that place. Man, last night we had such a good time. The Spirit of the Lord moved through that place. And man, and you could just feel it, man. And somebody stood in my yard today and said, man, the hairs on my arm was standing up. Hair on my neck was standing up. Listen, because you know what we did last night? We did some old-fashioned praise and worship. Amen. Amen. We need to get to that point where that's what's important to us, no matter what is important to the world. And then, oh, well, you know, it's just tradition. Tradition, I'm just going to go ahead and mark this down right here. You can just say this. Tradition will send you to hell.
Come on now.
Tradition will send you to hell. We need revival today in our churches all across the land because we're stuck in tradition. Tradition is a rut. And a rut is a grave with both ends kicked out. Amen? Tradition is going to send God's people sitting in churches all across America. Tradition is going to send them to hell. Oh, man. Four things we must do. There's four things we must do to have revival. Bring the glory back into the church. I'm talking about God's glory, not man's glory. We need to know that what the world thinks is not what God thinks. What is okay in the world isn't okay in the church. Sometimes the churches sit back and let just anything go. But thank God for a pastor. Thank God for some leadership. We need leadership in the churches. Thank God for a pastor that says, that's out of order right there. That may not be the right thing to do. Maybe this is the way we need to do it. Thank God for that pastor today. And we need more pastors across the land today that are standing in. You see, here in this story, anything went. It was almost as bad as Sodom and Gomorrah. Huh? Just go out there and take what you want. Don't y'all see that today? Take it by force. Take it by sneakery, by thievery. Just whatever you want, take it. And then we need to know that God is who he says he is. God is who he says he is. He said, I am the great I am. I'm the Alpha Omega. I'm the beginning and the end. I'm the first and I'm the last. He's everything in between too. Amen. God is everything that he says he is. Then we need to know what God expects of us. God expects us to be the best we can be every day. Even when nobody is watching you, be the best you can be. I miss my lawn, man. I'm going to tell you I miss my lawn, man, brother. My brother over here used to mow our lawn. He did such a good job. And he come to our house. He just come to do the yard and we'd leave a check for him. You never had to worry about anything being messed up in our lawn. He'd drive by the house and see a little piece of grass. He'd be a stop, pick up, and get out and snatch it off. I said, you sure do a good job. And he says, you know why I do it? As I'm pleasing the Lord.
That's the truth, brother.
I said, I do my job as I'm doing it unto the Lord, and it pleases the Lord. Man, I'm so thankful for him. I wish he'd come back, but he's too busy in the Lord. But that's how we ought to do our job, isn't it? Every day. No matter what we do. That's what God expects of us. God expects us to get up this morning and whether we hurt or not, put our best foot forward. And then God expects us. We wasn't standing there watching him cut the grass out the window going, boy, I think he's going to mess up. We wasn't driving by going, I bet Mr. Thomas ain't going to mow the yard today. We wasn't doing none of that. We knew it would be done. You know why? Because he did it as unto the Lord, and so he did it the same way, and he did it to the best of his ability, even when nobody else was watching.
Amen.
You'll catch that on the way home. Even when nobody else is watching, you should be the same. You should do the same as what God wants you to do. When your wife ain't watching, you should be the same. Amen. Men.
Amen.
If you were sitting there in Taco Bell, and some little cutie walks in half dressed. If you wouldn't look at her, if your wife was there, you sure better don't look at her when your wife's not there, because that ain't being a Christian right there.
Man.
You ain't gonna like that much, but that's the truth.
Man.
Then we need to put God first.
Yes, we do.
That's where we need to get to.
Amen.
And in America, is putting God first. I'm talking about putting God before that American flag, putting God before that.
Yeah.
I'm talking about putting God before you put your wife. I'm talking about putting God before you put your children. I'm talking about putting God before you put anything. If you put God first, then you'll have revival.
Amen.
You'll have revival in your spirit. You'll have revival in your home. You want to know how to end school shootings? Put God back into schools.
Amen.
And put God first, you'll end school shootings. You want to end the crime on the street? Put God first and you'll end crime on the street.
Amen.
But as long as we have that mentality that folks have today, listen, they had no king. Think about that today. How many people do you know that live their life as if they have no king?
Amen.
And if we'll live our life like we have a king, things will straighten out. You won't have to worry about gun bills. Listen, when I was a kid, we didn't have to worry about stuff like that. If somebody made you mad, you walked up and punched them in the mouth, and that was it. Now you make somebody mad, they sneak a pistol in a backpack and shoot you. Back then, we just bust somebody in the mouth and that was it. I'm telling you, we had a fight every year in our high school. A fight every year. The police knew we were going to have a fight about the same time every year. It was four different groups. And everybody got there and fought and fought and fought. Nobody ever once pulled a knife. Nobody pulled a baseball bat or a gun. We just fist fought till the law come and ran us off. Amen?
Amen.
We need to understand today that we have a key. You see, they had no key. Here's what happens when you don't have a key. That king in that day set authority. That king in that day set the rules. That king in that day, they could look forward to that king having an order in the kingdom. Guess what? We have a king. His name is King
Amen.
Jesus.
Yes.
We have a king today.
Yes.
We talk about revival. We pray for revival. We want revival. But we don't want to do what it takes to get revival. Pastor preached the other night on turn from your wicked ways. Ain't a whole lot of turning anymore.
Nope.
Ain't a whole lot of turning anymore. In fact, we're to the point we can't even turn a TV channel. We to the fact we can't even turn a radio station when it gets too wild. Huh? There's not a whole lot of turning today, Brother Ken. But I want to tell you today, we need to live under King Jesus. You see, they didn't have a king, and it was like Sodom and Gomorrah. It was bad. We have a king. Why is it so bad? Why is it so bad today? Why? Because daily, as Pastor said the other day, we don't crucify ourselves. Daily, we don't die. Listen, we have a key. The world may have an excuse to act the way they act, but the church ain't got no excuse. I said the church don't have no excuse.
Amen.
And the reason that we have so much problem is because a lot of people don't know the key. They don't know the key. And here's how you're going to get revival in churches and in our nation. Do your job as a Christian. And that's tell about Jesus everywhere you go. And live your life so that people could see something in you that would make them want to be like you. And you're going to have a whole lot of love from the Lord. You're going to have to show a whole lot of love, and you're going to have to show a whole lot of compassion. They had no key. Isn't it interesting that two verses in the Bible identically say the same thing? There's over 132 verses, I think, that directly say the same thing. But when I read this, I thought it was ironic that in Judges 17 and 16 and then again in Judges 21:25, said in those days there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Isn't that ironic? You think God wants us to know something out of those verses tonight?
Amen.
And that is that he is the king. They didn't have a king, but we have a king, and it's King Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, tonight as we look at you, King Jesus, God, I pray that, God, that we would humble ourselves. God, I pray that we would draw close to you. God, I pray that we would study your word.
Yes.
God, I pray that we would live by your word. God, I pray that we would love those who we come in contact with. God, I pray that folks would see something in us and make them want just a little bit more of you. God, if there's one here today that needs a touch from you, God, I pray that they would come because we have a king. We have a king.
Yes.
God, our nation should be in order today. And for sure, our churches should be in order today. God, we just love you and thank you. And we praise you today. Thank you for being our king in Jesus' name. Amen.